Let me just explain. My first couple slides are just context. I have a firm that I started 8 years ago in Western Canada in Vancouver. We're just architects. We're a private practice. We do projects all over the world. I'll show you a map of just the places we work. We work on all scales of buildings, from tiny little retail spaces and restaurants to towers to international airports. Some of the projects I've worked on include the Petronas Towers in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, which I was a young architect working on the team for, to big projects my firm has done, like the Vnukovo Airport in Moscow, for the mayor of Moscow as our client. So we work on a huge range of things, and I'm going to sort of jump forward and not really talk a lot about what we do, but a lot about what we see our role as architects in the greater context, and how that somewhat has informed my practice, but why I actually get out and do this speaking. And that's that, you know, I'm in a profession that's actually a fairly small profession with a huge level of influence in a way, and certainly an influence in the issue of climate change. Buildings are responsible for a huge component of the impact on the environment, and yet we are not really theoretically a very organized group. We're a bunch of small practices around the world trying to do our best to contribute, but we don't have a structure for really stepping back and looking at how we can influence systemic change in the way we build worldwide. So the only slide I will show you that's my work is this, and this is the kind of thing we do. But again, that's not really the point of my talk. These are all the different places we built. The blue dots are buildings that I've done in my own practice before I started my practice 8 years ago, and the red ones are where we're working today. That diversity of locations of buildings means that we see a huge range of issues. We're interested in not only what happens in our big cities in Canada, but also what's happening in the developing world. So we're engaging at both ends of the sort of economic spectrum as architects. Really what I'm here to talk about is this, that I believe that there is the two fundamental questions as an architect worldwide for us to tackle are the combination of these two issues, world housing and climate change, and how they are intrinsically linked in the reality that if we build and try to solve world housing, and I'm going to go into it, with the way we build today, that fundamentally we are going to make climate change worse. And in doing so, effectively solve one human need will actually create an even greater second human need. I noticed in Bjorn's talk, he doesn't have housing on that list of fundamental priorities, but the way I actually think about it is that there's sort of three things we need in our lives every single day, and one is food, and one is water, and one is some sort of shelter, especially as the climate gets hotter or colder or so forth. So let's just talk about world housing. The reality is, this is a UN Habitat statistic, is that 3 billion people in the world will need a new home in the next 20 years. That's the equivalent of 40% of the world needing a new affordable home. The reality of that is that around the world, 1 billion people live in slums, and 75 million people a year are moving into urban slums. That reality for me as a Canadian is two Canadas every year are moving in effectively to urban slums. That's a huge statistic, and currently we actually don't have a way globally to really think about how we're going to tackle the scale of that problem to provide for that human need. In the architecture profession, the conversation tends to be about how we are going to tackle green issues on a fairly micro level. So we tend to start seeing in the mainstream press a lot of conversations about buildings that are built in rammed earth or straw bale construction or these great techniques that are traditional techniques, and they're a wonderful conversation, or modular buildings, but they really lack the sort of perspective to realize that mainstream conversation is focused on the scale of problems that are really suburban scale problems, one house at a time. But the reality is that today 50% of the world live in urban environments, and by 2050, 70% of the world are going to live in urban environments, which means we need to really start thinking about how we address building in new ways for an urban context, which means very large buildings. So if we go into climate change, I think most of us are aware that roughly a third of the issues related to the environment and to climate change come from the building sector in one form or another. As I sort of talk about this, what I'm going to do is sort of leave one of the huge components to the side, which is energy, which is not, you know, it's sort of the way I look at it is energy issues are quite different in different parts of the world. The kinds of issues that I'm dealing with as a Canadian architect are quite different than the issues of the specific climates in other areas. And so I'm going to park that issue for now as part of my conversation and talk about the reality that as we think about the fact that 70% of the world are going to live in urban environments, for the most part, urban building structures are completely universal. So the incumbent materials are really steel and concrete.
Every city skyline across the world has buildings made of steel and concrete, and we don't think twice about it. Most architects, engineers, when they wake up in the morning with a new, fresh project, don't even think about that basic choice of the fact that they're going to build their building out of concrete because it's a 30-story tall office building. It's just a default that that's what our cities are built of. But there's some really fundamental things, choices, that we should be making and thinking about when we think with that perspective. One is that we have an enormous amount of concrete in the world that we produce. And in fact, it's the second largest material by volume that we build with. But its context when we consider the carbon footprint of concrete is this, is that roughly 1% of world carbon is coming from the airline industry and roughly 3% from shipping. But concrete represents, and it's fairly well established, a minimum of 5% of world carbon is coming from the concrete industry and the production of cement, up to upwards of 8%. So it depends whose statistic you're ultimately going to look to. But when you start to think about that choice that architects and engineers don't think about, when you just kind of get up and automatically assume we'll build a building out of steel or concrete, you can obviously see what that impact might be. So steel is also one of the most energy intensive materials. It represents about 4% of world energy is coming from steel. So it really kind of asks you that question, well, what choices do we really have? And the truth is, since for the last 100 years, we haven't really had any choices. We automatically default to these structures because we know they can build big. We know that we've sort of proven the fire science and life safety issues around these kinds of buildings. But what we also know is that really if we're going to address global carbon, we need to do these two things, and all of us are on board with this idea that we have to find ways to reduce emissions and find ways to remove carbon from the system. And as an architect, the only material that I get to build with that ultimately can do that is wood, which is obviously why I'm here with the sponsor. So the reality is that for every cubic meter of wood, roughly 1.6, this is softwood, 1.6 tons of carbon dioxide are stored within it. So that notion that if a tree falls to the forest floor and rots or burns, it gives off that carbon back to the atmosphere. But if you cut it down, move it into a building, use it in a structure, you're effectively getting this incredible storage capacity in the building. It seems like a very simple mechanism for us to rethink the way we build. So this is a Canadian statistic that our building, most of our homes are made with stick wood frame construction, which doesn't use very much wood, but the amazing statistic that it roughly 28 tons and we're driving a car for 7 years is stored within the wood in our homes. So there's some real fundamentals to that choice of making wood become part of this conversation of what we can build with, and that's, you know, really this fundamental issue that we also need to get much better in dealing with the sustainable management of our forests. And the two ways that I think about that is advanced forestry systems are really about the idea that we see in Central Europe, which is single-stem forestry, which really looks at the preservation of ecosystems. It's a reality that when you drive around in the countryside of Austria or Germany, you can't even tell there is a forestry industry because you don't see large tracts of forests that have been clear-cut, that those marketplaces nevertheless produce some of the best wood that we can buy as architects worldwide, and it's some of the cheapest wood that we can buy. So ironically, the formula of where the economics and the quality of forestry management work together, I think, is best proven in Central Europe, where single-stem forestry works. The issue here, and I guess I'm going to go a little bit into it in a second, but is that obviously a huge component of climate change has come from the fact that we've seen so much deforestation, especially in the southern hemisphere. And that's also a fundamental question that I'm often asked. Well, if we start building with more wood, what does that actually mean? Will that cause more deforestation? But not if we look at the proper management of our forests, and that it's very possible. In Canada, I live on the sort of doorstep of some of the, effectively the largest sustainably managed forests in the world. So the issue really becomes, okay, how do we then take an alternative to concrete or steel? And how do we take wood to allow us to start building bigger buildings? And to me, I think that the answer to that is really quite simply the issue of ambition. We haven't really had a sort of need or desire to want to rethink the way our skylines are built, because until really this discussion of climate change came about, we had a system that worked pretty well. Steel and concrete buildings are effective.